The Aesthetics of the Cangaço.
Eu tenho há muitos anos me dedicado ao estudo da violência rural.
Myself to the study of rural violence, banditry, and to the forms and manners in which this violence has permeated society in the backlands. And while studying how this phenomenon has functioned, very often I have found myself dealing with aspects that were more connected to art than to science. One aspect that has always been the greatest motivating force of my curiosity in studies concerning the Cangaço, a phenomenon that during so many decades, even centuries, has characterized rural life in the northeast of Brazil. The aspect that has most aroused my curiosity was the costume used by the cangaceiro. The cangaceiro's costume is something that differentiates it from all other social groups existent in and around the backlands. It reveals an ingenious functional complexity in the elements worn on the body, the equipment and the utensils, etc., and also presents an aesthetic impact, an extremely great artistic impact. Looking at photographs of the cangaceiros today, even with the limited resources of black and white, because color photographs only appeared at the end of the cangaceiro period in the 40s, one has the sensation of observing an extraterrestrial. This is a totally different kind of figure, with that enormous leather hat, the large characteristic side bag called bornal, the accessories all inlaid with gold, silver and eyelets, and all these pieces combining to create a composition of contrasting colors. And even when there is actually no color, then the contrast can easily be observed between light and dark. It is a costume that, as I have said in my publications, could be compared to the Japanese samurai or to the medieval European knights because of its grandiosity and majesty. And then, not only as a researcher, observing all this information from the data and above all the images, photos and films taken during the Cangaço period, apart from this data, there was one more detail that, in trying to comprehend the aesthetics of the Cangaço, led me on to further study. And that was the crisscross of testimonies given to me by people who were alive at that time, many of whom had actually met the cangaceiros just once during their lifetime. In all cases, for this person or this group of persons who had met a cangaceiro or a group of cangaceiros, the day they met them had become one of the most important days of their lives. It is a curious fact that very often the impact of this meeting brought with it a sensation of fear. If the person did not have an established friendship with the cangaceiro or was not close to them in any way, then the person would have to be very wary of an attack or some kind of threat at least. But often this impact had no relation whatsoever to fear. Why? Because either the person who was meeting the cangaceiro would have some relative in the gang itself, or he or she would be presented to them by someone known to the group. Consequently, there was no reason to be afraid of the cangaceiro. The group would not present a threat to them. But in all these cases, there was always a strong impact. Putting the aspect of fear to one side, we went on to investigate the lives of these witnesses, and what we discovered exactly was a declaration of aesthetic beauty. The dagger, inlaid with gold and silver. wide cartridge belts. The bags, bornais, embroidered with colorful flowers, complex embroideries. The neckerchief, often of colorful silk or taffeta.
O chapéu de couro, que é o grande ponto da concentração estética.
The leather hat, which is the great focal point of this aesthetic concentration, with the exaggerated use of gold, silver, stars, the sign of Solomon, protective signs of spiritual defense, items of an immaterial nature that could present some kind of risk to the cangaceiro.
Enfim, o encontro com o cangaceiro.
And so, meeting a cangaceiro, with the exclusion of the often present aspect of fear, produced, without any doubt, an extremely relevant aesthetic impact. It was highly sophisticated. For example, the jewels that the cangaceiros used, and it is curious to point out that they developed the habit of using a ring on every finger, and on some fingers, even two. There existed a somewhat ostentatious abuse. On this particular point, I am able to identify certain influences that have remained with us. There is a certain Moorish influence here, or Arab even, in the use of jewelry, the profusion of gold, silver, and the metal inlay in all the utensils. And many of these jewels, European jewels, of course, belonged to the rural elite of the Northeast, who, on facing an assault, were forced to hand them over. A large part of Lampion's jewels, his crucifix, for example, his gold ruby ring, the gold ring with his personal monogram on a gold sovereign, a large part of all this had been stolen during the celebrated attack on the Baroness of Agua Branca in 1922 and on Luiz Gonzaga Gomes Ferraz at the end of that same year. There were numerous celebrated cases which resulted in regular booties of European jewels and rings, etc. The seven gold chains that Maria Bonita wore, like Lampion's crucifix, had also originally belonged to the Baroness of Agua Branca. These European jewels made part of the whole aesthetic unit, giving it a very special touch of sophistication that was also to be encountered in their perfumes. During the 30s, Lampion indulged himself by using Fleur d'Amour from Roger et Gallet, a highly considered perfume, and that Lampion used to complete his personal refinement. This habit resulted from living alongside the powerful landowners of the backlands, men who would spend 6 months of the year in Europe and six back in the Northeast. Moreover, in the 1920s, Lampion went on to drink the menthol liqueur Marie Brizard, as well as his Old Tom English gin, his high-quality Ginebra rum, his brandy, the Portuguese Macieira, the famous five-star kind, as they called it. And then in the 30s, Lampion discovered and began drinking White Horse whiskey. With the information that I had collected in the study of the cangaceiro, in what I would call the sociological aspects, I came across a problem regarding the aspect of aesthetics or of art, which was to explain, initially to myself and immediately after to my readers, the reasons for such important, colorful, ostentatious costumes.
Ostensivo, tão imponente.
And here I will even use a term that the press of the time used to describe the arrival of the cangaceiros in a village, some backland settlement. And that word is carnival-like. They applied this description in order to characterize the cangaceiro's costume because of its majesty, its pomp, and the profusion of colors. The causes of this phenomenon are indeed most profound, since they reconstruct the early history of colonization.
The
colonizer arrives in Brazil. He does not encounter the goblins or monsters that mythology had disseminated throughout Europe as being the onus for whoever dared to navigate to the New World. Instead of this, he comes across something very curious and very strange, a universal man, ecumenical, essentially the same as himself, but that was at the same time profoundly different. And that made a tremendous impact on the soul of the colonizer, the observer of the colonized, the discovery, the fact that this New World man lived, as the documentation of the time states, with no laws and no king, and was happy.
Cada sendo, como alguns documentos disseram também,
each one then, as the documents state, was king unto himself, having the true intention of being his own king. And so this detail, as I see it, after exhaustive investigation, seems to be the origin of a certain pride, of an ostensiveness that exists throughout these social groups, and that in Brazil represented our irredentism, our lack of submissiveness, our rebelliousness. The Cangaço group, however, is part of an ampler context of which the old Levant Indians also made part, and that existed right from the 16th century with the capturing and enslavement of the natives. The Colombos that also began in the 14th century, that were destroyed and then renovated in the 17th century and throughout the entire colonization period. The revolutions instigated by the whites, the often referred to liberal revolutions, that, as certain authors such as Silvio Romero illustrated, were not revolutions with European characteristics, but were simply eruptions of violence, eruptions of the primitiveness of colonial existence, confronted with a society that had already begun to establish its control. It is important to mention Brazilian art, because after all, we are dealing here with a subject that speaks about this very point. With reference to this Brazilian art, I evoke the words of Gilberto Freire in his book The Master and the Slaves, with great authority, I feel. Brazilian art suffered a decharacterization. It suffered an assault from the very moment that religious education was introduced during the colonial period. Gilberto even expressly mentions that in Brazil, the Jesuits cut at the very roots any Brazilian art that had previously existed. It was our own, that came from our very origins. It would then cease to be an art as a projection of man, in benefit of an art that would become some type of composition or calligraphy, a copy of European patterns and lines, disseminated as being superior to ours, disseminated through education in a certain adulterated manner as being superior. So, if we analyze the panorama of Brazilian art from the point of view of the decharacterization that it suffered, losing the pure character of art as a projection of man, then we will discover in the aesthetics of the Cangaço an extremely valuable example of this art in its purest form, of this art that had as its protagonist a human group that maintained itself as irredentist throughout five centuries, because the Cangaço stretched from the very beginnings of colonization through to the 1940s. And so this group, because of its radical irredentism, living by the gun, living with no law and no king, of being a king unto itself, in terms of art, did not suffer this inductive adulteration of Jesuit or religious education. So we are going to discover a Cangaço art that is an art as the projection of man. This man who could beat his chest and say, I carry my art with me. My art is the brim of my hat. My art is on the flap of my bag. My art is in my cartridge belt, butt of my gun, my whole attire, the utensils that serve me as my equipment of war. Everything is decorated. Everything is adorned. Everything is alive with colored strips, with fringes, designs, lines, a profusion of colors, and above all, the symbol of Solomon that contains millennial religious significance and that represents a sign of defense against attacks by any malevolent spirit. There is a profusion of stars covering the brim of the hat, with varying quantities of points and characteristics. There are flowers on the side bag. And on the body of the leather hat, the use of the fleur-de-lis, which seems to evoke the Portuguese royal family of Avis, a primitive dynasty, or even some influence from the French royal family. Many of the cangaceiro symbols were borrowed from the lifestyle of the cowboy, because characteristically, the subculture that formed itself into the cangaceiro originated from an even greater culture, that of the pastoral environment, of the northeastern cowboy.
Mas há ponto em tudo isso que como que marcaria.
But there is an element contained within all of this which indicates its individuality, the identity of this popular art form developed by the cangaceiro, and of its aesthetics. And what differentiates it one way or another from what we understand in Brazil as being our popular art is the following. While this popular art form was born, and here I refer to ancient times, while it was born in circumstances of peace, it was also born in the circumstances of linking man to the deity, in a relationship of protection that could be the priori, such as the gargoyle, or the post-priori, such as the votive, just to give examples of the best-known Brazilian popular art.
Na arte do cangaceiro, nós vamos encontrar
in cangaceiro art, we encounter a great difference. The fact that it appeared in and was marked by circumstances of conflict. It is this risk factor that supplies an answer for the exacerbation of this art form, of the signs of defense, and of the symbols of protection, all of which contain a religious significance that are very often difficult to trace in time, as in the case of the sign of Solomon. One further interesting point to add to this would be the concentration of these aesthetics. I mean, it is of course important to mention the basic aesthetic symbols, those that I have previously mentioned, but it is interesting to observe the costume of the cangaceiro as a figure of synthesis. And we begin to encounter these concentrations. The flap of the bag with colorful floral motifs, the body straps decorated with eyelets, elements that permitted better air circulation. And these eyelets in white enamel also contain an aesthetic identity that harmonizes with the material underneath.
No sertão, o cangaceiro costurava, o cangaceiro bordava os grandes.
Throughout the backlands, the cangaceiro used to sew and embroider, as did the great leaders of the groups, including and above all, Lampião himself, who sewed and embroidered in an excellent fashion, and not only with material, but also in leather. He was adept at making fine leather clothes, and in general, the most successful group leaders were also those who were able to adorn themselves and adorn their subordinates to give them a feeling of pride of being fighters, the pride of being a participant in that small group, of that small, irredentist group. I remember one particular occasion on which I talked to the cangaceiro barreiro, I asked him, how was your life in the group? He worked with a cangaceiro called Portuguese, who was the chief of one of Lampião's subgroups. I asked him exactly how he used to adorn himself, decorate himself, and his answer was quite interesting.
Os outros tudo enfeitados, e eu sou nada, tô sem enfeite nenhum. Eu digo, Sr. Luiz, Luiz Pedro, senhor da São Lampião. Eu digo, Sr. Luiz, olha, eu quero me enfeitar, mas quem me enfeita é o senhor. O senhor me dá, me enfeita também, porque eu não tenho. Eu não tenho nada, os outros tudo aí enfeitados, e eu sem nada. E ele sorriu. Ele sorriu para mim quando acabou de lixar. Tá certo, Barreto? Abre um negócio lá bem assim. Então me enfeitou todinho. Me enfeitou. Não tem um cartucho de olho assim no lenço. No lenço. Não tem olho nas mãos. Me enfeitou.
Anel, aliança.
Tudo. Ficou aqui no lenço, aquele cartucho. E nas mãos, tudo. Foi ele que me enfeitou. Dentro do mato. Fechado, ele com a máquina de costura, costurando, fazendo bornar, couro, cartucheira, né? Couro, cartucheira, até roupa. Maria Bonita fazia a roupa, né? Aqueles enfeites todinhos que tinha, tem nessa roupa, era esse que fazia. Ele sabia fazer. É o que ele sabia fazer dentro. Fazia de linha, linha amarela, linha azul. Linha de todas as cores, bordado na mão. Fazer. Máquina de pé dentro do mato, e eles faziam.
Como bordadeira profissional e sempre fui admiradora dos bordados, eu tive a oportunidade de ver os bordados feitos nos bornais dos cangaceiros. É um ponto simples, mas que devia ter dado muito trabalho, pelo fato de ser, naquela época, só ter a máquina de mão, a máquina pequena, que se a gente movia com o que se chamava veio da máquina. São os bordados coloridos, feitos em ponto matiz ou em ponto corrido.
Some items were especially made by others, for example, the daggers. Were made by blacksmiths, who were the cutlers of the backlands, some of whom became famous, such as Ney Ferreiro in Água Branca, Alagoas, Zé de Martina in Triunfo, Pernambuco, José Pereira in Jardim, Ceará, and above all, João Jorge from Pau Ferro, which today is Itaíba in Pernambuco, and that during the 30s was a big supplier of daggers for Lampião and his gang. They are pieces with silver handles encrusted with rings of gold and ivory, and in the most exuberant manner, they constitute a very important part of the striking, aesthetically pleasing cangaceiro costume as a whole.
Dignas de uma apreciação.
This striking expression of cangaceiro art was strong enough to, shall we say, contaminate even the very forces of repression itself. The fact that the police adopted this same form of cangaceiro dress is an interesting point. In a very short time, the image of one and the other became confused. The cangaceiro confused with the monkey, as the cangaceiro used to call the police. Another important point here is how some of these aesthetic symbols were converted into representative symbols of the northeastern region. The rim of the hat turned up with the coins. the inlaid star, all went on to represent the image of the Northeast itself in advertising campaigns and numerous other representations of the area. What is important to register is that here we are not only dealing with details of the determined aesthetics linked to a subculture, but we are also dealing with the remaining unique vestiges of an expression of pride, carnival, noise, of colorful irredentist Brazilians, of the irredentist indigenous Levants, the black quilombos, the liberal revolution, and the various movements in which they were expressed, and from which no vestige has remained regarding the repression to destroy them. It goes on to become a kind of empty showcase in the Museum of Brazilian History, and it is this showcase that we will fill with the aesthetics of the cangaço, which brings together all its details and the remaining material spoils. It joins together all the irredentism and the great ideal, that primordial Brazilian myth, to live with no laws, with no king, and be happy.